يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين المنتجبين يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإن من شيء إلا عندنا خزائنه وما ننزله إلا بقدر معلوم. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات اللهم صل على Muhammad. For the love of Abba Abdullah al-Husayn, with the loudest of our voices, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. For the love of Imam Sahib al-Asir wa al-Zaman, arwahuna lahu al-fida, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuhu wa rahmatullah. Once again, we thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for gracing us with this wonderful moment, wonderful opportunity, this first day of the holy month of Ramadan and the second night of the holy month of Ramadan. We ask Allah azza wa jalla to accept our fast in this holy month and grant us with a lot of mercy and benedictions during the course of this month until the end of this month, inshallah. The verse I've just quoted from the glorious Quran for tonight, this course, is from Quran 15, verse 21. That is Surah Al-Hijr, where Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala talks about creation and the origin of each and everything that you see on the face of universe. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا عِندَنَا خَزَائِنُهُ وَمَا نُنَزِّلُهُ إِلَّا بِقَدَرٍ مَّعْلُومٍ. Allah says, whatever you see on the face of universe, you should know that the origin and the source of that particular thing is with Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. He then says, we release it when there is a need for it. We release it when there is a responsibility for it. Or else it will remain with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Departing from this verse of glorious Quran, brothers and sisters, our topic for today's discourse is to talk about the beginning and the end. And our examination will be of three stages. The first stage, and all the examinations, so to speak, is based on the report received from Mawla'i Kainat, Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wa salamahu alayhi. The first phase of our examination is to ask ourselves where we were. And the second phase of the examination is where are we. And the third part of examination is where are we heading towards to. And as I said, this is based on the teachings of our Mawla, where Mawla'i Kainat made dua. And you know, Ahlul Bayt al-Asma wa al-Tahara, now and then they make dua for their lovers and their followers. And you know, the dua of a ma'sumin, there is no obstacle between it and the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mawla'i Kainat made dua, Rahimallahu abdan, arifa min ayn, wa fi ayn, wa ila ayn. Amir al-Mu'mineen made dua, may the blessings and the peace of Allah be upon a servant. Who is that servant? Who knows where he was and know where he is and know where he or she heading towards to. This is a natural question that now and then we ask ourselves as to where we were. I have an example. If a person is involved in an accident, may God forbid, or a person is in a coma and the person is taken to hospital without knowing what is happening, The moment he or she is able to open the eyes, the first question is where I am. This is a natural question that comes back and forth in the mind of each and every one of us. So Mawlai Kainat made dua, Allah's blessings and mercy and rahmah be upon a servant and a slave who knows where he was and where he is and where you are heading towards to. Let us unpack this subject, the beginning and the end, for us to understand the need for spirituality and the need to become neighbors to our Creator and the need to feel the presence of Allah wherever we find ourselves, be it in the mosque or Imam Barga. Wherever you are, you need to feel the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for us to feel that presence of Allah, we need to be able to answer these three questions. Therefore, what is the beginning? Where were we? And where were you? Quran, in many verses of Quran, highlights as to where each and every one of us was. And as to what is our source and what is our origin. Because if you do understand your source and you do understand your origin, you will then appreciate the source and appreciate the origin. You will then try to be connected to that origin. But if you do not understand and recognize your source and your origin, you will not be able to relate to that origin and you will not be able to connect with that origin. Allah, in the Holy Quran, in the first verse I quoted, he said, the origin of everything is with us, Allah. You see plants, you see animals, you see insan. Your source is Allah. Your origin is Allah. You are all from Allah. You were once in a state of non-existence, and out of his infinite mercy and love for each and every one of us, he granted you this existence. So our source is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if our source and origin is with Allah, then what is with Allah will remain, and what is not with Allah, it will perish. And this is what Quran mentioned. Pay attention. مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَضْ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقْ. Whatever is with you, it will come to an end. It's limited. It's restricted. But whatever is with Allah, it will remain forever and ever. So your origin is Allah. Your source is Allah. That origin is there. And each and every one of us will go back to that origin. Look at another verse of Quran, Surah Al-Ra'd, verse 17. Allah cited an example with water, a rain. He said, أَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءَ فَسَالَتْ أَوْدِيَةً بِقَدَرِهَا. Allahu Akbar. It's not only insan. Even the origin of rain is with Allah. And Allah says, when the rain pours and it reaches this world, then it becomes in measurement. But if it is with us, it is a reality and not measurement. The same thing, your origin is reality. It's not measurement. But this world, we are in size, we are in shape, we are in measurement. So, أَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَسَالَتْ أَوْدِيَةً بِقَدَرِهَا. The same thing, Allah give an example with Quran, where Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, Inna anzalnahu Qur'anan Arabiyyan la'allakum taqilun wa innahu fi ummil kitab. Look at Allah. Ladayna la'aliyyun hakim. Allah says, we reveal this Quran in Arabic language, but when it was with us, it was a reality. It was not in Arabic. So the origin of everything is with Allah. But when it arrives here in this world, it then becomes in measurement. You have the shape, you have the size, you have the material. It gets dominated by material. And one other verse where Allah highlights more about this Quran, he said, كِتَابٌ أُحْكِمَتْ آيَاتُ ثُمَّ فُصِّلَتْ مِنْ لَدُنْ حَكِيمٍ خَبِيرٌ. He said, that book which is Quran, when it was with us, it was Hakim. Means reality. But when it came to this word, fusilat, then we made it into different parts and shapes for I and you to be able to realize, recite and understand. So in short, what I'm trying to say in this introduction is that our origin is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not have any other source except Allah. Now come with me, follow me. To move from one point to another, there are two types of movement. If you like, to relocate from one city to another city, or from one house to another house, there are two types of relocations and movements. The first one is relocation or movement based on manifestation. I'll explain to you what does it mean. And the second one is to relocate completely. The first one, no. I am born in London, but I now base in Birmingham. My origin is London. I am here just for greener pasture to make some money. But whatever money I make, I will not invest in Birmingham. I will invest in London. That's your origin. You are attached to your origin. You are attached to the house where you were born. So whatever you do, your heart is connected. When things get right, you run away and go back to your origin. They said, when we all came to this world from Allah, we are in this world as manifestations of the power and the qudra of Allah. We are not here permanently and completely that I will not go back again. No! I am here for a certain period of time. I need to go back to my origin one day, one night. So this is what they call nuzul. Ala nahwi tajalli. I am manifestation of Allah's power. Therefore, Allah made each and every one of us his ambassador and vicegerent on the face of universe. Where he says, Inni ja'ilum fil ardi khalifa. Now, for Allah to let us know in Quran as to why we are in this world and what he expects from each us, he indicated to many verses of Quran that you are here and you need to come back to your origin. And here, brothers and sisters, when I talk of coming back to your origin, I'm not talking about dying. I'm talking about spiritual journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where you give that heart to Allah and you feel the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever you are in this world. Therefore, one verse Allah will tell us, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Here, the first meaning, of course, we are from Allah and we will die, isn't it? But the second meaning, no. We have all ascended or descended from Allah. When did you descend from Allah? The day you become a matured person. The day you become baligh. Wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And we are all ascending to Allah with our souls and our heart. That is spiritual journey. So we are here as manifestations of Allah's mercy and Allah's rahmah. The same thing one ayah of Quran said. Kama bada'akum ta'ulu. The way he began with you, you will go back to him again. So therefore, it is the month to get connected with the world of the unseen. It is the month to get connected with your origin. It is the month to get connected with your sources. It is the month to get connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is an opportunity that I need to understand who I am. Now the next question is, where are we? Everybody will say we are in the dunya. But in reality, where are we? Now we know where we are all coming from. We are from Allah. He is our source. So whatever I do, I need to connect to Allah. I cannot forget my source. I cannot do away with my source. I need to be with my source now and then. Where are we? You know, this world plays two roles the moment you find yourself in this world. And these two roles are, in actual sense, two limitations. It imposes on each and every one of us limitation of time and limitation of space. We are all limited by time and we are limited by space. Therefore, we are naqis. We are incomplete. Because the world is controlled by material. And it is dominated by material. And because of that, we are limited by time and we are limited by space. If you look at the time now, it's 9 o'clock. We are all limited by 9 o'clock and not 1 past 9 or 10 past 9. And the same thing, we are all here. Some of us may have big houses. Some of us may have big mansions. But for now, we are all limited by this space of Imam Baraka. That tells you insan is in prison. He needs to work harder to get out of that prison. And therefore, Allah in Quran throws more light on this world and where we are. Where Allah says, because of all these limitations, limitations of time, limitation of space, this world became an environment of imtihan and temptations. Where Allah said, Alladhi khalaqa al-mawta wal-hayata liyabluwakum ayyukum ahsanu amala. He is the one who created the death and the life. For what? So that he will examine you to see who will do the right thing. So therefore this world, because of that limitation, we are in a field of examination. We are in a field of battle. Your soul is battling every day. Nafsul lawama, nafsul amara, nafsul mutmainna. They are battling every day. Something is telling you go to the mosque. Something is telling you do not go to the mosque. Something is telling you do charity. Something is telling you do not do the charity. Something is telling you it's your enemy. Something is telling you it's not your enemy. Something is telling you make your salat on time. Something tells you, do not do, there is more time. We are in the world of temptations. We are in the world of examinations because of this limitation. But you see, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, because of His love for us, knowing that we are in this world of temptation, He provided us with two ways. Where He says in Quran, Inna hadayna un najidain, imma shakiran wa imma kafura. I know you are in the world of temptations. I know you are limited by time. I know you are limited by space. But I provide for you two ways. You either take this way or take that other way. In Surah Al-Kahf, فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Whoever wants to believe should believe, so be it. And whoever doesn't want to believe, so be it. At the end of the day, it's your prerogative, it's in your hand. Either you want to follow Allah or you don't want to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah, to emphasize more, He ordained that every day in your salah, you should repeat and chant, Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. So that He can keep you in that sirat al-mustaqim, to be able to know where you are and where you are heading towards to. And Allah, these ways that He has provided us, He provided us with esoteric guidance and exoteric guidance. Esoteric guidance is that guidance in the form of our conscience and our intellect. And the other one is in the form of Rasulullah and Ahl Bayt al-Isma wa Tahara. Therefore, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, knowing that we are limited in this world, He requires from each and every one of us to start making a move. You have to make a haraka, a type of a movement that will free you from this slavery, that will free you from this imprisonment, a movement that will make you feel the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever you find yourself in. Therefore, they said we have three types of movements. The first movement is a movement of place. Haraka makaniya. You have to move from one point to another. And the common teaching of Rasulullah, where Rasulullah alayhi salawatu wa alayhi al-musallin, umma salli alayhi Muhammad. He said, utlub al-ilma walau bisin. Seek knowledge of guidance, even if it takes you to China. Rasulullah is trying to say, for you to free yourself from that imprisonment, you need to acquire the understanding of your religion and to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number two is the movement of space, or time rather. That movement of time is when Allah created us from being a young child to becoming adolescent or teenager and to become old. These are all phases of life that Allah wants you to acquire knowledge and understanding. And the third movement is movement within yourself, which is the most important movement. As you're sitting next to me, you see, your mind will be going from known to unknown and from unknown to known. You know, your mind will be going up and down. Every point one mentioned, your mind will be moving from one point to another. So you need this type of movement to take you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, Allah, when He created us, the first guidance He gave us, as young children as we were, Allah provided us with three types of guidance and three types of knowledge. You take every child, every one of us as a child. If you look at your child, the first knowledge provided to that child by Allah, they call it ilm hissi. It is sensory knowledge. What is sensory knowledge? When a child look at your face, smiling face, you are smiling. These eyes transfer that smiling into the mind of the child. That's a knowledge Allah has given to the child. And it is a natural knowledge. And the second knowledge is imaginary knowledge, as they call it. What is imaginary knowledge? Now the child, when he see that smiling face, and when he see that other face, the child is able to store it and repeat it in his or her mind now and then. And the third knowledge given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which we need it also, a child will look at the face of the father and look at the face of the mother. When the father hug the child, when the mother hug the child will give it a meaning to say, this means love. But the fourth one is the most important one. That is the power of intellect given to us by Allah. Allah, out of all this knowledge, the powerful one is the power of intellect. Where Allah in Quran said, وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّعَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ. He said, Allah is the one who removed all of you from the wombs of your moms when you knew nothing. Then after that, He provided with hearing and seeing and provided you with this intellect. Here my point on the guidance which can take us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the emphasis of Quran on the importance of the sense of hearing. You see, when you go to Quran, there are about 130 verses where Allah mentioned about the sense of hearing. That sense of hearing is the most powerful sense in the life of each and every one of us. And therefore Allah repeated in Quran. And why it is the most powerful sense in the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is because of two major reasons. The first reason is a psychological reason. And the second reason is a natural reason. What is a psychological reason? You know, we are told by scholars, the first sense to work in a person is the sense of hearing. And the last sense to work in a person is the sense of hearing. Which means, Quran and Islam taught us, when a woman is expecting, she should listen to the verses of Quran. Why? Because the sense of the child is the first sense to work within the womb of the mother. The same thing when a person dies. When you go to Kabristan, what do? You recite Talqin. Why do you recite Talqin? Because we believe that the last sense to work is the sense of hearing. So therefore, it's a guidance from Allah that Allah repeatedly in Quran mentioned about the sense of hearing. But the second one is the most important one to me, which is a physical reason as to why Allah repeatedly in Quran mentioned about the sense of hearing. Because scholars, based on the teachings of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Imam said, your sense of hearing is a door to your heart. The opener to your heart is your sense of hearing. When your sense of hearing is active properly, then it feeds and supplies your heart and your soul. Therefore, you find in many verses of Quran, Allah, when He talks in Surah Al-Jinn, He said, قُلْ أُوْهِيَ إِلَيَّ أَنَّهُ اسْتَمَعَ نَفَرٌ مِّنَ الْجِنِ. When those group of jinns, استَمَعَ, they listen and heard Rasulullah reciting Quran, what do they say? فَقَالُوا إِنَّا سَمِعِنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا. When they heard Rasulullah reciting, that tells us if you want to get to Allah, if you want to know who you are, if you want to know where you are heading towards to, watch out your sense of hearing. When they heard the Rasul, he said, "Inna sami'na Quran and ajaba." We've heard a very astonishing recitation. Fa'amanna bihi, and then we believe in it. Another verse of Quran, which is very important. Allah says, وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ تَرَى أَعْيُنَهُمْ تَفِيدُ مِنَ الدَّمَى. When believers and lovers of Allah hear what befalls the Holy Prophet, tears will start overflowing from their eyes. So that means that when I hear and I understand, that tears will start overflowing from my eyes. The same thing we have a dua. رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا سَمِعْنَا مُنَادِيًا يُنَادِي لِلْإِيمَانِ أَنْ آمِنُوا بِرَبِّكُمْ فَآمَنَّا. Said, "Ya Allah, we heard the caller calling. When we heard him calling, then we believe in our Lord." So the sense of hearing is so important sense. It is the door. If you want to give life to your soul, watch out your sense of hearing. And if you want to kill your soul and destroy your soul, watch out your sense of hearing. Therefore, you find the people of Noah, alayhi salatu wassalam, when you call them and call them and call them, what do they do? وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغَفِرَ لَهُمْ جَعَلُوا أَصَابِئَهُمْ فِي آذَانِهِمْ. Noah said, "Ya Allah, whenever I had called them for you, Allah, to forgive them, what would they do? They will place their fingers into their ears, and they will cover their faces and head with pieces of cloth." So if you don't want your soul to be alive in accordance to the teachings of Allah, then you don't listen properly. Therefore, Allah concludes the argument about his lovers and followers. He said, "They are those yastami'una al-kawla fayattabi'una ahsana." They are those, when they listen, they don't just listen and take everything. Once they are able to listen, they take the good out of all what they have listened and they leave the rest. So therefore, our sense of hearing, brothers and sisters, is the most powerful sense, which is given to us by Allah to lead us to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, in conclusion, how do we use this sense of hearing to go back to our origin? We know we are from Allah. And in this world is the world of temptations. It's the world of examination. It is the world of limitation. We are so limited and we are in prison. But if I want to get out of this prison, if I want to be free, I need to make sure I make good use of my sense of hearing. Once I'm able to make good use of it, it will lead me to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you study the question of sense of hearing, what comes in place is the question of emotion. Therefore, we are told the insan is emotional human being. What is that emotional human being? It is something, when you start to make ibadah, that emotion has to be seen in your ibadah. Ibadah without emotion is not ibadah. So therefore, for me to connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I need to bring all these senses, I need to bring all this intellect, so that I'm able to connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, scholars came forward and said, when you look at the month of Ramadan, the month of Ramadan is the month for you to be able to put all your emotions and intellect under control to lead you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, they said, those who fast in the month of Ramadan are of three groups. All of us sitting here, and all those who are fasting, we fall under one of these three. So you look at these three and decide which one of them you want to belong to. The first group are those who fast. But when they fast, it's only abstinence from food, water, and family. Done. These are the first groups. They fast. But it's only about food, about water, and about family. Done. The second group, no. They said, no, it's not about food. It's not about water. It's not about family. These are not a big deal. All parts of my body are also fasting. My eyes, my ears, my nose, my hand, my tongue, they are all fasting. The third group said, no. It's not about food and water. It's not about all parts of my body. even my imagination fasts. I do not imagine evil in Ramadan. I do not think of evilness in Ramadan. And this is where we truly understand that this third part or this third type of a fasting is the fast we make dua yesterday or today. Allahumma ja'al siyamana siyama sa'imin. Wa qiyamana qiyamal qa'imin. Allah make our fast among the fast of those who fast. And our qiyamul layl among the qiyamul layl of those who stand up at night. They said it is referring to the third part of fasting or that type of fasting whereby the whole conscience and the whole imagination and the whole system of insan is fasting in the month of Ramadan. So therefore, in conclusion, brothers and sisters, let us try as much as we can to give all parts of our body to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to give proper attention to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as that will help us to connect with our source. And we will become the verification of that riwayah of Imam Amir, and we will all be covered by the dua of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, alayhi salatu wassalam. We ask Allah to forgive us, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inspire us with his teachings. We ask Allah azza wa jalla to accept our fast in this holy month of Ramadan. Wa akhir da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallillahumma ala Muhammadin wa alihi at-tahirin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.